which is through Narayan Hrudayalay. He did his PhD from 2013 to 2015 from Narayan Hrudayalay, Institute of Cardiac Sciences, Bangalore, and also went on further to do his FTE, that is Fellowship in Transesophageal Echocardiography, from the same institute. He has also done his Fellowship in Pediatric Anesthesia in 2011 from Wadia Children's Hospital, Mumbai. So welcome, Dr. Vaibhav. So I now call upon Dr. Vaibhav to speak on this topic. Dr. Vaibhav, you can share your screen.
Good morning, everybody. Screen is already shared, sir. Nope. Screen is already shared.
Sir, you will have to reshare.
Reshare. Yeah, I can see your screen now.
Okay. Good morning, everyone. Should I start? So today's topic of discussion is inotropes. We are discussing four drugs in it, which are most commonly used: adrenaline, noradrenaline, dopamine, and dobutamine. So we'll start with definition of inotropes. These are the pharmacological agents that have ability to restore and augment myocardial activity, raise blood pressure, and increase the cardiac output and tissue perfusion. So there are two types of inotropes, basically: positive inotropes and negative inotropy. Here we are going to see only positive inotropes. So inotropy ejection and all the contract. Frank Starling law explains the relationship between the preload, that is myocardial length, and the strength of contraction, that is inotropy. So here we can see how positive inotropy shifts the curve from A to C, that increases the stroke volume and reduces the LVEDP, and negative inotropy shifts it down from A to B, where it causes decrease in stroke volume at higher LVEDP. So what is expected from our ideal inotrope is it should enhance the contractile state by increasing velocity and force of myocardial shortening. It should not affect the heart rate, should not cause any dysrhythmias. It should elevate perfusion pressure by raising cardiac output rather than SVR. It should redistribute the blood flow to vital organs. It should be directly acting, should lack tolerance. It should not produce any vasoconstriction. It should be easily controllable, and it should be compatible with other drugs. It should be effective orally and parenterally. And one of the important thing is it should not be expensive. So this is basically how it is classified into sympathomimetics, phosphodiesterase inhibitor, and the newer drugs, out of which we are mainly going to see on this column catecholamines, where we are dealing with adrenaline, noradrenaline, dopamine, and dobutamine. So how they are synthesized, basically three of them are endogenous and one is synthetic, that is dobutamine. So say they are synthesized from this phenylalanine. Tyrosine hydroxylase is the enzyme which is the rate limiting step. Then dopamine, and which is precursor of norepinephrine, and it is which is formed in all adrenergic neuron, and in adrenal medulla, norepinephrine is converted to epinephrine. So how they are metabolized? In short, we can see these three the catecholamines are endogenously metabolized by monoamine oxidase and catechol O methyl transferase enzyme, and they are converted to metanephrine, normetanephrine, and 3-4 VMA, and they which are excreted in urine. They are very short acting. These are very short acting drugs and have very early onset of action. Then in short about the receptors on which they act. These are alpha receptors and beta receptors. The dopamine has separate set of receptor called dopaminergic receptor. So alpha receptors are located on the vascular walls. It is associated with vasoconstriction. They are also present in heart, which increase the duration of contraction. Beta 1 receptors are primarily associated with inotropy, chronotropy. They cause minimal vasoconstriction. and beta 2 receptor are associated with vasodilatation, increase in the lactate and glucose level that we associate with some of the inotropes. So dopamine, these receptors are seen in the renal, splanchnic, coronary and cerebral blood flow. And they have their dose dependent action, which is also a matter of discussion now, and they can induce noradrenaline release. So in short, how these things work. So beta agonist work through G protein coupled receptor, which causes increase in cyclic AMP, which causes calcium channel activation and increase in cytosolic calcium, which leads to direct positive chronotropy, that is increase in heart rate. Then this cytosolic calcium will increase the actin myosin troponin interaction, which will lead to positive inotropy. Cyclic AMP also increases cyclic AMP dependent protein kinases and increase phosphorylation of phospholamban protein, which augments calcium uptake by sarcoplasmic reticulum, and this will cause vasodilatation in the smooth muscles. Vasodilatation. Then about the alpha agonist. So these acts through different G protein, which leads to activation of phospholipase C and forms 1,2 diacetylglycerol, and this IP3 is formed, which increases cytosolic calcium, and it increases the calmodulin dependent protein kinases, which leads to vasoconstriction. So this, in short, we can see how these receptors and the inotropes have their action on. So alpha receptor mainly associated with vasoconstriction, beta receptor are related to inotropic and chronotropic activity, beta 2 are mainly associated with vasodilatation, and dopamine is associated with natriuresis, the splanchnic vasodilatation, which gives you this so-called renal protective action. So adrenaline, as you can see, has major positive inotropy and chronotropy. It also has vasoconstriction, vasoconstrictive properties. Noradrenaline is preferred vasopressor or vasoconstrictor. And then dopamine has dose-dependent activity, which we will discuss during individual drug. And dobutamine per se has predominant beta-1 agonistic or the inotropic action. So what is the main goal or utility of the inotrope in our treatment? So the main goal is to increase tissue perfusion and oxygenation. This is done by increasing the cardiac output, which is related to stroke volume and heart rate. So inotrope and chronotropic action works here. Vasopressor, it increases SVR, it increases systolic and diastolic blood pressure, and increases the perfusion, increases the coronary perfusion also. So we'll start first with adrenaline. So it is an endogenous catecholamine. It acts on both alpha and beta receptors. At low doses, it acts on beta 1 and beta 2 receptor, which causes vasodilatation and inotropy. Alpha effects comes at higher dose. So increase in heart rate, increase in coronary blood flow, it causes vasoconstriction, increase in arterial blood pressure and pulmonary artery pressure. So, as I told you, at lower doses, it causes beta stimulation, leads to vasodilatation and inotropy. This is at 2 to 10, it will cause alpha and beta. At higher doses, it will cause alpha action. So, dose is in one ampule, 1 milligram is 1,000 is there. For infusion, it is 0.05 to 0.03 microgram per kg per minute. In CPR, we use 1 milligram bolus followed by 20 ml push every 2 to 3 or 3 to 5 per minute, 3 to 4, 5 minutes. In pediatrics, we use 0.1 ml per kg of 1 in 10,000 IV. So it is mainly used in cardiac arrest, failure, peripheral vascular collapse, anaphylaxis, and bronchospasm in our setting. It is also used in some glaucoma and other effects. Adverse effect being hypertension, tachycardia, extravasation, pallor, dizziness, hyperglycemia, palpitation, and headache. So some important points are that with prolonged infusion, the receptors are desensitized and downregulated, also seen in chronic heart failure. Relative affinity of these receptors is altered in hypoxia and acidosis, which formed an important postulate in using vasopressin during CPR, but now it is not used. High and prolonged doses causes direct cardiac toxicity, leading to focal regions of myocardial contraction, band necrosis, and stimulation of myocyte apoptosis. So this is, in short, what we have seen about epinephrine. It is used in cardiogenic and vasodilatory shock, cardiac arrest, bronchospasm, anaphylaxis, symptomatic bradycardia, heart block, unresponsive to atropine and pacing. Majority is beta 1, and it causes potent vasoconstriction at higher doses. It can cause major side effects like ventricular arrhythmias, hypertension, cerebrovascular hemorrhage, and sudden cardiac death. Next, we go to the noradrenaline. So it is also endogenous catecholamines liberated by postadrenergic nerve endings. It acts mainly through alpha receptor, causing vasoconstriction, which causes increase in SVR and pulmonary vascular resistance. It causes increase in blood pressure, both systolic, diastolic, and pulse pressure is increased, and increase in pulmonary artery pressure. It has mild inotropy and chronotropy. So this alpha 1 muscle on the vascular, which will cause blood vessel to constrict. So it causes increased coronary blood flow by increasing diastolic blood pressure, and also release of local vasodilators from myocytes. It prolonged infusion also of this noradrenaline also can lead to direct toxic effects on myocytes and apoptosis. So this noradrenaline is associated with reflex bradycardia due to increase in MAP and baroreceptor stimulation. So the heart rate is minimally changed when you use noradrenaline, or it is associated with bradycardia. So it is indicated mainly, it is a mainstay in shock with decreased SVR, which can be septic and neurogenic. There are alternatives to it, which we'll see later. It is also used in cardiogenic shock where we are unable to maintain MAP with dobutamine or dobutamine alone. Utility in TET span is questionable. So it increase limitation being it increases heart afterload and tissue perfusion. So these are some of the trials or the research done on noradrenaline, which I thought it will be useful in vasoplegic syndrome, which is known entity after cardiac surgery. Noradrenaline forms important pillar in treatment. Vasopressin has come up as a study showed that vasopressin as an effective alternative for norepinephrine in vasoplegic syndrome. So this paper, impact of routine norepinephrine on hemodilution and blood transfusion and in cardiac surgery, where they started norepinephrine at a low dose in cardiac surgery perioperative period, and found out that we tend to give less fluid and cause less hemodilution by that use of less blood products during cardiac surgery with norepinephrine use. So at the end, again, the revision, it is used in vasodilatory shock, dose being 0.01 to 3 microgram per kg per minute, potent alpha 1 blocker, potent alpha 1 stimulator, and major side effects being arrhythmia, bradycardia, peripheral ischemia, hypertension, especially if the patient on non-selective beta blocker. Next is dobutamine. So dobutamine in these four drugs, today's four drugs, is the best inotrope, as I would put it, available. It is a synthetic catecholamine. It acts through beta 1 and beta 2 receptors with beta 1 selectivity 3 times higher than the beta 2. It is a potent inotrope and weak chronotropic activity. So it causes increase in the cardiac output and decrease in the PCWP. It causes mild vasodilatation at lower doses because of the beta 2 stimulation. Inotropy without SVR increase is seen up to 15 microgram per kg per minute. At higher doses, SVR increases because of alpha effects. Now chronotropy leads to increase in the oxygen demand and consumption. So it limits its utility in cardiogenic shock, but it's a drug of choice in cardiogenic shock with high PA pressure and also in RV dysfunction. So it's a good choice when the situation is with the patient has poor perfusion and high SVR due to vasoconstriction. So it causes the limitations being it causes tolerance, it can cause ventricular arrhythmias, it is not used in sepsis, but as a preferred inotrope, but it is used in sepsis with patients with documented cardiac dysfunction. So noradrenaline being preferred choice in sepsis, dobutamine is only used when there is cardiac dysfunction. It is contraindicated in idiopathic hypertrophic subaortic stenosis. So a few papers on this one. The dobutamine, because it is a good inotrope, we tend to use it routinely. So this paper has seen that dobutamine or any inotrope for that matter should be used only when it is indicated. This and these are the trials where these people, this Lido trial, Ruslan trial, Survive, Revive 1 and Revive 2 have compared levosimendan as an effective alternative to dobutamine in various treatments of heart failure, and they have seen it as an effective option. In Survive study only, they have seen the long term mortality with levosimendan and dobutamine there was no difference, but 25% reduction in the mortality was the endpoint of that study. So this is what it is. Survive trial, the reduction in mortality in near term was significant, but in 180 days it was not significant between levosimendan and dobutamine. So this is the difference between dobutamine and dopamine. It is naturally acting and this is synthetic. It is pure. This dobutamine is pure adrenergic. It has a decreased effect on the blood pressure. It has more arrhythmogenicity, but it is a more consistent inotrope. The renal action of dopamine is questionable. Then between dobutamine and milrinone, both are equipotent. It causes dobutamine causes significant increase of heart rate and pulmonary artery pressure. The milrinone is a potent pulmonary vasodilator. It causes mild increase in the oxygen consumption, or sometimes it doesn't cause, but dobutamine causes increase in the oxygen consumption. So with milrinone, this cardiac output is moderately increased. And the change after the CP bypass, there is unchanged sensitivity with milrinone. So dobutamine, it is, in summary, it is used in low cardiac output in decompensated heart failure, cardiogenic shock, sepsis-induced myocardial dysfunction, symptomatic bradycardia. It can be used. It is selective beta-1 agonist, and it causes side effect being tachycardia, ventricular arrhythmias, cardiac ischemia, hypertension, sometimes hypotension. Then the last one is the dopamine. So dopamine is also endogenous catecholamine, precursor of noradrenaline. It acts mainly on D1, D2 receptors. Also at higher doses, it causes alpha and beta agonistic action. So there is dose-dependent action associated with dopamine, with renal and mesenteric vasodilatation at 2 to 5 microgram per kg per minute, forming the basis of the renal low-dose dopamine for renal protection. And at higher doses, it causes peripheral vasoconstriction. It is useful additional inotrope in cardiogenic and septic shock and CHF. So this is the dose-dependent action which we were talking about in dopamine. If it is less than 5 microgram, it causes increase in the renal blood flow and decrease acts on proximal tubule, causing natriuresis, also splanchnic blood flow due to vasodilatory properties. In 5 to 10, it increases contractility and minimal change in heart rate and SVR and increase in renal and splanchnic blood flow. At more than 10 microgram per kg, majority is the increase in the heart rate and vasoconstrictor. So it's used as an adjunct to the other inotropes. It is useful in bradycardia. Renal protection is very questionable. And the limitation being it is less potent as compared to adrenaline and noradrenaline. Larger doses cause tachycardia and vasoconstriction. So these are the papers which question the utility of dopamine, the low dose dopamine. This paper though as questions is utility only, and the side effects it has shown is like on the renal front, on different trial, it has shown no benefits in mortality, use of hemodialysis, or benefits on the renal protection action. In gut, it causes increase in the mucosal ischemic injury. It predisposes to a patient to hypopituitarism and hypothyroidism. And in respiratory, it blunts the ventilatory drive of the patient. And this one, this also compares to renal protection in cardiac surgery, a choice between dopamine and dexmedetomidine. Dexmedetomidine being used because of its antioxidant properties, but they didn't find the dopamine being advantageous. So dopamine, in summary, it is useful in shock, heart failure, symptomatic bradycardia, dose range being 2 to 20%, 2 to 20 microgram per kg per minute. It has action on alpha, beta, and dopaminergic receptors. It causes severe hypertension, ventricular arrhythmias, and it can cause cardiac ischemia also. So after the discussing four drugs, we will see evidence of these inotropes in some important cardiac conditions. So firstly, myocardial infarction. So inotropes are mainly useful in situation of cardiogenic shock complicating myocardial infarction, which is like cardiac index less than 2.2, also blood pressure less than, systolic blood pressure less than 90. So here you can see inotropes causes increase in oxygen demand, arrhythmia, infarction expansion, and contraction gland necrosis as a disadvantage. But the hemodynamic effect due to hypotension, which is there in cardiogenic shock due to MI, which leads to increase in LVADP and decreased cardiac output, overweighs the disadvantages. So it is useful to have inotropic therapy. So it is only for, it is not a definitive treatment. It is useful as a bridge to definitive therapy. So this is the trial which shows early revascularization in myocardial. Myocardial infarction complicated by cardiogenic shock is indicated, and the inotropes are used as a bridge only. So how it should be? It should be lowest possible doses which should be used. Dobutamine is the first choice if the systolic BP is between 70 to 100 and there are absence of signs and symptoms of shock. We can add dopamine if the signs and symptoms of shock are present. Higher dose may achieve inotropy and alpha stimulation, and which will lead to increase in the end organ ischemia. Hence, combination is used. Third inotrope, if needed, if there is hypotension, norepinephrine can be added. Next is right ventricular reinfarction. So what happens is normally RV preload, normal contractility, normal LV preload, RV afterload, and in normal LV contractility leads to normal cardiac output. In right ventricular infarction, what happens is RV contractility goes down. So there is decreased blood flow to the pulmonary system. LV preload goes down. So cardiac output decreases. Also, due to septum, movement of septum towards LV, septum is moved to more towards LV. So there is impaired filling and contractility. So dobutamine here is the preferred inotrope with increased systolic performance, decreased pulmonary artery pressure, and it improves the AV conduction. Bilirubin, levosimendan also are very promising, and norepinephrine is used to maintain the mean arterial pressure. So this is a good paper to read, acute management of right ventricular myocardial infarction. Then in perioperative cardiac surgery, the use of inotrope in perioperative cardiac surgery, we are well versed with, we are all using it routinely. The indications being, we use it during weaning from CPB, if there is low cardiac output syndrome and evidence of low end organ perfusion. Low cardiac output syndrome in these settings can be due to cardioplegia-induced dysfunction, systemic inflammatory response syndrome, ischemia during cross-clamp period, reperfusion injury, and pre-existing cardiac disease. So this inotropic treatment, if needed, anotropic treatment for during this period is needed, but other measures also should be kept in mind, like fluids, sedation to the patient, and pacing. The patient should be hemodynamically optimized. Then preemptive support is also considered in certain conditions if the patient, but it is controversial. Dobutamine is preferred agent, but mirlinone and levosimendan are emerging good alternatives. Noradrenaline, adrenaline, vasopressin are also used depending upon the hemodynamics of the patient. So this is the paper which questions us for using inotropes perioperatively during the cardiac surgery. So in this paper, they have compared the dobutamine and dobutamine sparing in perioperative period in cardiac surgery, and they have found there is no difference in the outcome. So the inference being less is just as good as with inotropes. Then we have sepsis. Sepsis is life-threatening organ dysfunction caused by infection-induced dysregulated host response. So inotropes are useful in hemodynamic stabilization part of the sepsis management. It forms only part of management of the sepsis with fluid resuscitation. So during the in sepsis, norepinephrine forms the first choice inotrope. Epinephrine, dobutamine are also useful. With norepinephrine, dopamine is usually combined. Epinephrine causes increase in lactate level, but it is not too high in the recommended doses. Dobutamine is only used if there is myocardial dysfunction, which is documented during sepsis. So this dopamine versus norepinephrine in the septic shock, the meta-analysis where they saw higher mortality and arrhythmias with dopamine also in comparison with norepinephrine. In COVID settings at present, as we can see in this, the preferred agent is norepinephrine as the first line vasoactive agent. For adults in COVID-19 and shock, if norepinephrine is not available, vasopressin or epinephrine can be used, but the evidence is weak. For adults with COVID-19 shock, the dopamine use is not indicated. Then the mean arterial pressure of 60 to 65 as in sepsis, it is the same. And for persistent cardiac dysfunction and persistent hypoperfusion despite fluid resuscitation and norepinephrine, dobutamine is suggested over increasing norepinephrine use. And then we have cardiac arrest. So during CPR protocol, the epinephrine is the recommended drug where we use it as a 1 milligram bolus every 3 to 5 minutes. The thing to be remembered in this setting is larger boluses like 2 milligram or 3 milligram is not useful. Then we have bradyarrhythmias where epinephrine and dopamine are useful. In pediatric setting, only epinephrine is recommended. So this is the survey where they did across the Europe, where they found out what are the indications of inotropes. So in septic shock, there is good evidence. Then inotrope with cardiogenic shock, again, inotrope should be used. It is not indicated in hypovolemic shock. Inotropes, first fluid resuscitation should be done. Inotropes is only supportive treatment. Then the choice of inotrope, dobutamine as a first choice, very good. Dopamine is not recommended as an inotrope. Then triggers for inotropic support is low cardiac output. It's a good low cardiac output is a good trigger. Signs of hypoperfusion as a trigger for inotropic support, again a good trigger. Then the inotropic support, as we are discussing, should always be target oriented. So low cardiac output is one of the targets, sign of hypoperfusion, and dosing should be stopped when patient experiences unacceptable side effects and if it shows clinical improvement. So to conclude here, inotropes and vasopressor form important in supportive care in many cardiac conditions. Treatment and their use should always be goal directed. Overuse should be avoided. combination of inotrope is useful than using single agent at higher doses because it decreases the side effect of the primary agent. Like dobutamine, it will not cause tachycardia and vasoconstriction if you use any other inotrope with it. So routine use of inotrope is not recommended. Quick re-establishment to oral therapy or destination therapy like cardiac transplant or LVAD is advised. Larger trials focusing on clinical outcome are needed to better assess the clinical efficacy of these patients. Thank you. Have a wonderful day.
Thank you, Dr. Vaibhav. Thank you for that wonderful lecture. I think so all the students, even we have benefited from us. Thank you for going through the basics, like what is the inotrope, what are the qualities of an ideal inotrope, and then what receptors it acts on, and then going through the four inotropes, and then also what are the current papers which have been supporting and also for and which have been not for it. I now invite Madam Vaishali Mohar, Madam, to give her viewpoint, her expert views. Dr. Vaishali.
Excellent presentation, Vaibhav. Am I audible?
Yes, Madam. Yeah.
It is my pleasure to be here because Vaibhav, I'm my MD student and I have seen him as a budding anesthetist. And now he is a very good cardiac consultant. Cardiac surgery has done very well. It was a excellent presentation by you, Vaibhav, and you really revised everything, presented all the basic, I would like to add only thing that mean arterial maintenance of mean arterial pressure more than 60 to 65. These are the guidelines, AHA guidelines of 2017. And they say that the noradrenaline is better than other agents. But when we started cardiac surgery practice, only three agents were used: dopamine, noradrenaline, and adrenaline. After that, dobutamine was introduced. And then came milrinone, levosimendan, all the newer agents. So I don't think newer cardiac anesthetists are using adrenaline or dopamine or noradrenaline. Of course, they are using. But the use should be based on the choice of any inotropic agent or any vasopressor. It should be based on clinical scenarios and etiology. And it should give you the desired effect. And you should be comfortable with that particular agent. So my advice would be you should follow the protocols you are used to or your institution is using. Because every institution is using different inotropes and vasopressors. So old timers used to use adrenaline, dopamine very frequently. Now they are not using. Now we have shifted to dobutamine and NORAD. And now again on milrinone, levosimendan, according to the requirement. So after initial treatment with the fluid challenge, you should go ahead with the short support of inotropic agent. Whenever you are coming off bypass, you should decide how is your cardiac output or what is the diastolic pressure, and accordingly you should choose. And during various other ICU managements also, you should choose the inotrope wisely. So it is not that one particular inotrope is applicable to everywhere. So according to the situation, the clinical scenario and etiology, you should go ahead. And you should be comfortable. It should give you desired effect. This is what I would like to say.
So, Madam, do you feel that with the advent of these new inodilators like limelinone and levosimendan, do you think dopamine and dobutamine are on the way out? How, what do you feel? But this was asked.
No, they will never be way out. Never. See we you are comfortable use means you should be comfortable with that. So dobutamine will be never way out. Even dopamine will be never way out. So we are not talking about only the situation in the cities. We should talk about the peripheries also where it is not available. So interiors, if you are going, this is not available. So whatever is available or whatever government is providing to the people are using and they are getting desired effects. So how to use is very important. And the thing is, even if you are using dopamine, how you should titrate is very important. You should know the dose of that particular agent and how to use and where to use in what situation you are using. So that should be very important, because everywhere levosimendan is not available. Even milnidone is not available. Monitoring during these agents is very important. Monitoring, whatever monitoring, advanced monitors you are requiring, it is very important. So while giving all these agents, whether you are used to all these agents, whether you have used it previously, that things also are also very important. So I think these are the time-tested agents. All the four agents are time-tested one, and we are used. So it is very important that people should make it comfortable, or even the newer generation make them comfortable with these agents.
Yeah, I agree with you, madam. I also would like to make your comment that, especially in the ICU, I think so, even Vaibhav will agree with me that what we used to do, like most of us are now doing, even the FATE, that is a focused assessed transthoracic echocardiography. So there are just those four basic views, and even in the ICU, if we can just just do a simple echo, we can just come to know what is the contractility, we can come to know what is the preload, afterload. And we can come down on an inotrope, because inotrope just keep running, in the ICU, maybe just night, overnight, and then we start tapering. But if it is not required, it's not required. It's a very good contracting heart. Just hypovolemia, we can just come down on the inotropes, I think. So that is one of this. One of the other things that even I am taking the liberty that Kamlesh is there in that. So even I want to ask him is in pediatric, because since he, what is his... is the inotropes in pediatrics. So since he is a limb, sorry for taking, it's an impromptu one, but I would like to ask you this before we start the Q&A to shoot all the Q&A to both of them. I just want a small, couple of minutes from you.
Hi, good morning, madam. Good morning, Vaibhav. It was an excellent presentation, and you covered most of the aspect as well as the recent literature regarding the four inotropes which you have been given to talk on. So my opinion will be purely on pediatric cardiac. So there are a lot of difference of practice in adult cardiac and pediatric cardiac. So please don't take my kind of points and extrapolate on adult cardiac practice, because it is totally different. So coming to the first inotrope, I think dopamine and dobutamine, what I feel is gradually the role of dopamine and dobutamine is reducing for the pediatric cardiac, because dopamine is not so much of useful, especially in neonates when the receptor are not well developed. And then if you want to use a dopamine, we need to use on a higher doses. So compared, people are more comfortable using a low dose of adrenaline rather than using a dopamine on a higher dose. So that is, and I think most of the other countries, they are now not at all using dopamine. The same thing happening with the dobutamine also for pediatric cardiac surgery, because use of milnidone has significantly impacted the reduction of users in dobutamine, because of dobutamine itself causes a lot of tachycardia, and the pediatric cardiac patients already higher is on heart rate. So a lot of tachyarrhythmias, which is associated with pediatric cardiac surgery, and that will even precipitate with the dobutamine. So milnidone is having a beneficiary effect on this aspect as well as on pH and the SVR. So use of milnidone has significantly reduced use of dobutamine pediatric cardiac practice. But as madam has said that if it is not available, it is good alternative to use dobutamine rather than select some agent as an alternative to milnidone, because some of the good pediatric cardiac units still practice of using dobutamine. It is not obsolete, but it is obviously the choice at present tilted towards milnidone. Coming to the adrenaline and noradrenaline, adrenaline is a drug of choice in pediatric cardiac and neonatal complex cardiac surgery. And people try to use with a lower dose rather than going on very high dose. But yes, that is the drug of choice, very easily available, very cheap, and very reliable also. And most of us as a cardiac anesthetic, I think we are very comfortable of using adrenaline. And we know our own experience also. So adrenaline is, I think, going to be the mainstay for even pediatric and neonatal complex surgery. Coming to the noradrenaline, the use of noradrenaline also is not very high as compared to the adult cardiac practice, because adult cardiac practice, most of the time you maintain the SVR and the heart will not be much problem. In pediatric cardiac, I think failing heart and you are increasing the SVR with noradrenaline, it is going to harm the patient's overall outcome, especially in lower cardiac output state. So use of noradrenaline also restricted to the fewer, only few kind of subset rather than universally accepted. Yeah, one of the vasoplegia kind of a conditions, yeah, when the patient is having very high hematocrit and you're coming off with a lower hematocrit, I think you maintain the SVR with some small dose of noradrenaline is recommended. So I think use of noradrenaline also is not very vast as compared to the adult cardiac practice in pediatric cardiac. And then now people are comparing vasopressin versus noradrenaline. Vasopressin obviously score higher compared to noradrenaline, even in sepsis, early sepsis, and even the effect of coronary on vasopressin compared to noradrenaline, and benefitory effect on pH of vasopressin compared to noradrenaline. So I think people are tilting, if someone wants to have a kind of thinking about noradrenaline, people are moving forward to use vasopressin rather than using noradrenaline, because it has added advantage and covering most of the positive point of noradrenaline. So I think these are all my opinion, but yes, as madam is saying, if you are comfortable with one of the combination of inotrope and if it is working for you and your patient, then it is not kind of bad at all. It is individual. Gradually the unit grow up with that inotrope, and if you are getting a effect or desire results, then it is okay of whatever the combination it's working for you. Thank you
Kamlesh. So now to just want to ask Vaibhav and madam is a couple of questions. That what do you think about a combination of inotropes? Sometimes there is a like a Christmas tree of inotropes going on, like 1, 2, 3 exactly, they are going at high doses. So what is your take on that? So that's a question. So any of you can answer.
Combination of inotropes, again, the use of inotropes per se is only temporary, to overcome temporary situation towards clinical stability of the patient. So combination of inotropes should be used keeping the treatment goals in the mind. It should not be that a patient is having hypotension and we are going up on noradrenaline till the toes are black. So the end organ perfusion, you can see, you have, like you mentioned already, the point of care techniques are available with 2D echo, easily available, then ABGs, lactates, everything is there. So supportive treatment and the combination of inotrope is used, but as I told, it should be at the lowest dose possible for the lowest duration possible. So then it is useful. So as the things are uneventful, it goes on, and with low inotrope support, as perioperatively we can see, and if the patient has then after in the postoperative period developed sepsis or sepsis-induced cardiomyopathy or some other problems, where we can use some combination, but at lowest dose possible.
I agree. Also, what is the, there's a question like about noradrenaline, definitely because of its vasoconstrictor effects. It has a lot of effects like other on, you know, on your splanchnic circulation, on your renal circulation. So what is that dose where you would be really alarmed, or, you know, or you would, your alarm bells would start ringing as to, I should now be careful and you know, which earlier. So what is the dose of norad where you think, it's what your experience, what is the dose which you would stop at, like, and... Any of you?
So,
madam, go ahead, Vaibhav.
So, noradrenaline. Okay, in our practice, noradrenaline use is very limited perioperatively. So, we get alarmed even if we start noradrenaline in our setup. So, anywhere between, if it crosses 0.1. Microgram per kg per minute in pediatrics, we are like very cautious for use of noradrenaline, and we will use the other inotropes instead of noradrenaline. sometimes we do add very low dose of vasopressin when we are going up on noradrenaline and come down on noradrenaline per se. So we use noradrenaline for vasopressin at say 0.003 to 0.006 microunits per minute per kg per minute to reduce the requirement of noradrenaline. It has to meet the clinical endpoint. If we are getting good urine output, peripheral pulses, warm patient at a lower dose with lower mean arterial pressure, we do accept it.
I totally agree with you, madam.
I think everyone agrees that lower doses will be beneficial for all the patients, even in the perioperative cardiac surgery. While coming off bypass also, if the patient is having anemia, only increasing the inotropes and air is of no use. You should treat the cause. So everything should be in the whatever clinical scenario you are going, whether the patient is losing blood, patient is having anemia, patient is having hypothermia or something like that, you should treat the cause. And then you think of putting the patient on inotropic support or vasopressors, whatever is comfortable for you, is what I feel. That you treat the cause. The cause of less cardiac output and whatever this mean arterial pressure or something like that, that should be find out first. And if you want to treat the patient with Paxil or you have to transfuse the patient, blood loss is more, first transfuse it and see. Simultaneously, you can start with the vasopressors and then you adjust the dose accordingly. Or in as a Vaibhav said, in ICU setups, we should find out the things. Even in cardiac surgery also, we should find out the thing, the LV volume, how much is the LV volume and how the contractility is. So all these things we can very well, nowadays we can monitor very well. So before starting, whether you want vasodilators, whether you want vasopressors, whether you want inotropes, it should be decided on table. And then we should go ahead with the things.
I agree. So as you said, Vaibhav, that dopamine as a renal dose, which which is always a controversy. So what is your take on that still? Both of you, madam also can comment, and you also, because what is your take on that?
I don't support use of dopamine as a renoprotective agent. It's been proven beyond doubt, and there are many papers. And during this presentation, I came across even more papers supporting that dopamine has very low recommendation or no recommendation as a renoprotective agent. So in one of the paper, what it is saying is when it is compared to NORAD, basically maintenance of cardiac output improves the renal function and helps the renal function to improve. So NORAD is better than dopamine. And if you use dopamine and there is a hypovolemic state and fluid resuscitation levels is less, it will cause harm to the kidney rather than giving him beneficial effect. So use of dopamine as a renoprotective agent is very questionable for me.
I think now it is obsolete. Initially, people used to use dopamine as a renal dose. But now I think no one is using it. Rather, maintaining cardiac output and mean arterial pressure is more important for the kidney to perfuse and for the urine output.
Yeah, so I think so. It's good like this. Thank you for this. So even I feel that when we are on inotropes, assess your patient both clinically as well as get your labs also done. If your mixed venous saturation, everything is, it's increasing, or if your lactates are increasing, it may be because of, the harmful effects of the, definitely if they require inotropes, they require, but if they do not require inotropes, kindly come down on the inotropes. But in the end, these are drugs which should not be used and we should not be misused, I would say. So thank you. For the students, I think so. It's a wonderful presentation. So next time you get any of these photons, don't look at the ampule. Just start saying that it gives a very bad impression. You start looking at the ampule and then you tell what's that. Because you have been using this drug for the last 2 years.
They should keep disadvantage of also in mind while saying it.
Pardon, madam?
They should keep disadvantages of those drugs in mind while using it.
Yeah, so that's why you should know everything. What are the actions, disadvantages, and Vaibhav has given us wonderful trip, because if you're doing really good, the examiners may even ask you what the latest trials on these drugs. So you can even say on the survive trials, that helps you to get more marks in your exam. So thank you once again for that wonderful presentation. I think so it has benefited not only us, for all the students. So thank you, Dr. Vaibhav. Thank you, Vaishali madam. Thank you for that wonderful input. And
thank you, Ayakta,
all the attendees for spending this Sunday morning with us. So we'll just like to remind you that on this coming Saturday, that is the 26th of June, we are having a webinar on anesthesia for minimally invasive cardiac surgery. So we have good speakers. We have even international speakers from we have international speakers from Minnesota and also from Delhi. So we will send you the flyers shortly. So thank you once again, all of you. So thank you. Thank you, Kamlesh, also for that wonderful input. Thank you once again.
Thank you.
Sir, ending the meeting now.
Thank you all.